All I have is what's in there, yeah? That belongs to me. The thing to do is to keep people out of it. Well, unless you invite them in, as I'm inviting you in, fine? But that's, as a guest, you can come into my head. But my head is private, it belongs to me. I must fight to keep control of what's in there and not let other people get inside it and march all over it, you know? So that's the reason, really, that I write poetry, but I write poetry for me. And what I do then is I take the top off my head and let the ideas and the images just fall out, but then it's only for me. I protect the inside of that, and I won't allow anybody in unless I invite them. So I distrust psychiatrists. I don't want anybody coming inside my head. You know, it's like my house. That's where they want to get, the producers, that's where the machine wants to get inside your head. They want to take over the inside and turn it into what they want it to be. In the early days of Hollywood, they would have straightened that nose, then they'd have given me another operation to straighten that eye, they'd have cut my hair short, they'd have trimmed a bit off my chin, and I would have looked like everybody else instead of looking like this. Does that look like me? This head I try to keep separate from that one, you know?
Yeah.
There are two heads on my shoulders. Yeah. That one works for me. That's the one that I put on for other people, you know? Not for friends, but for hustlers. It's the majority of the people in this business.
Right.
End of the head. Sit. Stay. No. See what happens? Doing sketches is never directed against people, it's only directed against props. I'm against anything which I think to be anti-human, you know. Machines, by their very nature, are anti-human. If they weren't, there wouldn't be machines. They don't think. I don't like objects which are programmed to perform functions and only perform those functions. Things which have, which do not have an intelligence. Robots are useless creatures. Computers are useless things. They have to be programmed by people. We seem to be getting to a stage of our society where we believe that they are more important than the people. But without the people to program them, they don't exist. And the man is still more important than the machine. Take away the man, there isn't a machine. Take away the machine, there's still a man.
Yeah, Young Frankenstein. So Mel Brooks, the guy who did the producers.
Yes.
Well, Mel had co-written it with Gene Wilder, Peter Boyle, and myself. Jupiter is young Frankenstein, inherits Frankenstein's estate. Peter Boyle plays the monster. He agreed to play. What's the play? The monster that we've done.
Is that Matty's intention all the time? He doesn't want to walk. He's got to run. He wants to be able to do it all very quickly. I think that's Marty's biggest failing. Honest to God, I really do. The perfectionist in him, he takes it too far. I know everybody says, well, thank God, you know, it's good to be a perfectionist. But if you're that much of a perfectionist, then you can lose sight of something terribly good. And he has done. I remember watching the show once, and it was all bad as far as he was concerned, but he was wrong. Don't tell me not to smoke.
What? You smoke as many as
you won't there. Nag me no. at all until no. tomorrow.
Pling plong. Where is it?
Put it on the table.
Yeah. Do what? Wind it? Yeah. It's a music box. Oh, now I know what it is.
No, you keep going the right way.
Well, it's lovely. Well, I tacked out a list, which I told you about the other night, or three or four nights ago. I couldn't sleep, and I got up and I thought, who am I? I thought, I am the sum total of everybody who has influenced me. That's a lot of people. And I just typed out the list. Shall I read it?
Yeah.
I've got it here. Actually, it's like my autobiography. Yeah? It's the autobiography of my psyche, if you like. People who have influenced me. Samuel Beckett, Charlie Parker, Buster Keaton, Herman Hesse, Peter Osgood, Muhammad Ali, Spike Milligan, Mark Rothko, Enrico Olmi, Jacques Tati, Stanley Matthews, the footballer, Harpo Marx, Stan Laurel, Oliver Hardy too, but more Stan Laurel, you know, because he edited and directed, and his vision informed me much more than Oliver Hardy's, who was a creation of Stan Laurel's in a way, you know. The list could go on. That's where I finished, because I just ran out. It's not in any particular order, but I thought, each one of these people has some way influenced my attitude to life or the way in which I look at life. Mostly, I've tried to find any common denominators, and there are some. There's some which I can't understand yet myself. But I just put them down, kind of free association, typed them all out, and then went to bed. I went back to bed. Well, I think all those, that's my autobiography, plus the sum total of me. Well, I feel about Keaton like the average organ player feels about Bach. Do you know, I can't describe it more than that. It transcends influence. He's the most perfect thing I ever saw, you know. He's an object lesson for every comedian, I think, for every visual comedian. Well, not only for a comedian, for a painter, for a poet, for a musician, for anyone, you know. It happens that I'm a comedian and Buster Keaton was a comedian. The difference is qualitative. He had genius and I merely have talent. He's important to me for other reasons too, because I see the way that Keaton's career went, that somebody as great as Keaton, and you can't get any greater, was destroyed by the Hollywood machine. He went to MGM and MGM really ate him up. They put supervisors, producers, accountants all around him, and they took away his freedom and they destroyed him. And I keep thinking of Keaton, I carry his photo around to remind me of what the system can do to me too, if it can do it to Keaton, who was the best of them all, and it can easily do it to me. Oh, just knowing that could happen to him. Well, if it could happen to him, it could much easier happen to me, you know. So I just keep the photo around as a reminder. There's a small photo of Keaton I always take with me wherever I go. Just to remind me of that, whenever I'm being bullshitted by agents and by producers and people who I know do not have the same interests as I do. My interest is only in doing the show. Their interests have to do with making money or saving money, which comes to the same thing.
Chat, chat, chat. God bless. And that's official. Da-da-da-da.
Of death and human dignity in the face of life to, and death and survival.
Related to the community too.
He's very into survival,
yeah,
actually.
Yeah. Closing on our store did much better about our environment.
Yeah.
And God knows, I've seen almost everything replay I've ever seen did it better on the level of personal relationship.
But I didn't miss anything.
Yes, it did, curious enough. Seeing those sort of things just make you feel very angry, which stimulate. I find it very stimulating. Be made angry by that kind of thing. Yeah. I want to ring up and complain.
Yeah.
At the same time, I want to get something good on to show that that's what it's about. You know.
Oh, no. I like all the symbolism, like the fire engine in the trough of water. The little kid's fire engine.
Oh yes.
Leave
yes.
that in there.
Yeah.
Now so we take it out.
Oh, so heavy-handed. It was heavy-handedly poetic. Leon Griffith, who used to be a writer.
Yeah.
Are we taking Sam? This is Leon Griffith, who used to be a writer.
Well, no.
I've decided
to become a
comedian.
I'm up there, one. Very underweight at Lacoste. Thank you, Mr. Christian.
No, just.
Cider.
It's turning away from people.
Sure. Because then you
obviously eating
him.
Another sleepless night coming up.
Give us
one. Two. No, they're not mine. They belong to you.
Come up here. No,
thank you.
He's never seen Germany, and I think he might... Would you like to go to Germany? It's very nice. Marty likes it there, and he likes you. He thinks you're a very nice dog. I don't. Now, I'm going to put him in your little box out there, and you're going to take him.
He wants to go, look.
You're going to Germany in a couple of weeks.
Dogs are supposed to care about you. We go in 3 months, we come back. Dog doesn't give a shit, not interested. Just walks straight past us. A couple of woof, 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 you know, hello, it's nice to see you. God, he doesn't care about us. Good.
I told you, he'll go with anybody. Really? Yeah. So don't be surprised, I'll put him in your suitcase. You can have him.
In fact, I never looked through photographs, except you asked me to for the film, but
yes.
I haven't looked at the photographs for years. Got some here, which from when we were in Fiji a couple of years ago. They're nice to look at. Jesus. I don't know how much anybody is of a shit by their childhood. It's much more than you know, I suppose. You know, I'm shaped by all kinds of genetic things, hereditary things. Which have nothing to do with my own experience, but my parents' experience and their parents in Russia and in Poland. There are two things I can remember. I can remember lying in a pram, and I can remember the girl who was looking after me. My mother was in the markets, working in the markets. I can remember her flushing a feather duster in my face, and I can remember screaming and crying. And I've been terrified of birds ever since. I won't go anywhere near a bird, live or dead. It may be that. That's clearly in my mind. My second memory, when I was about 3 or 4, must be about 4, because they didn't let you in movies before. That was a Laurel and Hardy picture, which I saw again about 2 years ago, and I remembered it almost. I can say I remember it frame for frame, but I remembered it very accurately. I also remember telling my parents. I remember telling them that I wasn't their son, that I was Bing Crosby's son. So that obviously had a tremendous influence on me then. And I'd been, just when war started, it's been 5, that I'd, obviously I was fantasizing then, that I'd been dropped by parachute into England, and I was Bing Crosby's son, and I was also somehow a spy. I couldn't work out how things related. I may be Bing Crosby's son, I haven't talked to him about this. You know? My memories of my childhood, it was fairly solitary, because my mother and father worked in the markets until I was 5 years old, and then the war came. And when the war came, my mother continued working in the markets, and my father joined the army. So I was looked after, evacuated into the country, and looked after by strange families. Memories of being a solitary kid, especially when I was evacuated into the country, because I was the odd one out. All the other kids came from the country. I became a vegetarian at about that time, when I was 5 or 6. When I saw them kill animals, and serve them up on the table. When you're a kid, the only animals that you ever see, I remember seeing not horses, but the policeman's horses, dogs, cats, pigeons, none of the animals that you eat. And then when I was evacuated into the country, I used to get to know a rabbit on the farm, and the next day that rabbit would be served for lunch. And when I realized I was eating secondhand dead bodies, I gave up eating meat and I haven't eaten it since. So that was fairly traumatic.
Well, he was a very mischievous child, a very positive child, strong-willed. I don't think he's changed very much through the ages. He still hasn't grown up. He's very creative, artistic, in fact. When he was about 10, he wrote and directed a play for his school. I think that must have been the first signs that he ever showed of his creative genius.
My mother's, I recognised a lot of my mother in me too. A more practical side. My father was not, for all the fact that he was a wonderful businessman, he died broke because he ploughed it all back into the business, or gave it away, or spent it, or gave it to friends. My mother was more practical. She's also calmer than my father. I'm a cross between the two. What he did have was a great instinct for comedy. He loved comedy. He never liked watching anybody else do it, but he was a spontaneous performer. You know, he'd be terribly funny in conversation, visually as well as verbally.
He didn't want me ever to become an actor. Probably because it seemed too easy to him, you know. Comedy was so accessible to him, he couldn't understand why anybody wanted to do it, you know. Probably also equated with the first generation Jew living in England, having made some money, which he did, towards the end of his life, and wanting what he considered to be better things for me. Not able to understand, I just wanted to do what he did, just to make my own life, you know. Parents very often don't understand. Children don't want to be lawyers and solicitors or anything. All they want is the same opportunities to develop their personalities or express themselves. My father's tremendous influence on me. I don't know how much of a coincidence it is that the year that he died, within 3 months, I'd become an actor, a comic.
It's like this every morning, I tell you. 15 years and I still fancy that.
Get out. See you later.
Bye.
Just before the
so we've got both versions.
Before the chord.
Both taken from the breath.
Yeah.
Okay. So it's one from the chord to the tints, and one from the chord to the end.
Yeah.
We know one's a short one, one's a long one.
Okay, just let me check.
Down is the long one.
But I don't care by heck, 'cause I love the back of your neck. Your eyes are mean, your teeth are green, your hair is just a wreck. But I love the back of your neck. Your speech is slow and halting. Most folk think you are revolting. To walk round you and see the view is really quite a trek. But I love the back of your neck.
Ladies and gentlemen, owing to circumstances beyond our control and the control of the government, the management regret to announce that Marty Feldman will appear tonight.
Right!
Hit the pants!
Hit the pants!
Here we call the
Of Muddy Felton, it has been said many times. He is in fact a very intelligent person, who is very interested in the sea and in painting.
Once in a lifetime, there comes an act which is destined, wherever it goes, to create a storm of apathy.
Stop cutting your part!
Such an act has come to Derby tonight. Ladies and gentlemen, 15 tiny toes tapping their way to the top. The three Long John Silver brothers.
With me. Oh, ah! Yeah!
and the one about to
just do this, it'll give you a cut.
Rolly, come in my camera. Do you want to stay up? Chris Rolly's changing.
Do you mind me? You got me.
Do you don't mind?
I don't. Okay.
Okay. Let Germany see the McLeod legs, why not?
Don't
concentrate. No, we'll dub Germany. Roland's legs are dubbed for Germany, by the way.
Great.
These aren't his real legs, we dub them.
The special German legs dubbed for Germany.
Jürgen Schiller dubs his legs for Germany. Can't post-sync them because he only has one.
Ah, that's true. How was it, Marty?
Terrible.
Why is that?
A lot of mistakes. The sound was awful. We were okay, we were messy. If it were a dress rehearsal, I'd say, well, okay, great, we had another day to go, but we haven't. That was it.
How about the audience?
Oh, they were lovely. They were great when they could hear it. Yes, I think a lot of the time they couldn't hear it. In a sketch that you've done before that gets laughs, if it gets small laughs, then you know it may be you. If it gets none, then you know that it's because they can't hear it, because they can't see it. So I think the sound is a thing to be sorted out.
Yeah.
It's new for us. We have all kinds of problems like the bench collapsing. God, I don't know how to finish this.
I don't know. The bench collapsed, the invention collapsed.
Well, that's what collapsed the invention. I fell off the bench onto the invention.
Was that what it was?
Yeah.
Oh.
But I put it carefully under the bench so I could never hit it. Little dreaming.
Little did you know. That's
a bug out bench. I think we should get a little.
We've got to get a bench. A little bench. Used to a chair. Pilots was dicky too. I don't think they had that.
I forgot what to come on.
They didn't get the point of pilots early enough. Somehow it's us to blame. It didn't work for some reason. I don't know.
It was working by the end.
Oh yeah, sure. But it took them a long while to get the point.
So what are you doing? What are you doing then? Ah, can I say hello? Well, in a minute when I talk to you. For a start, it's interesting working in a club. You're working in a club, you're competing with a lot of other things. I wanted to know if I could do that, if I could hold an audience's attention, not a committed audience, you know? It seems I can. I don't think we did a good show last night, you know, but obviously they like what we do, basically. Interesting, the review in the local paper, it says, audience is very much divided. There are those who fell about laughing from start to finish, and there are others who sat looking thoroughly confused. Now, that won't happen in theatre. They won't be confused. They wouldn't come. You know, they don't like it. Here, you don't have a captive audience. So it's interesting for me to find out, A, if I can get through to the people who are confused, and B, whether I want to. You know, like, I'm not going to live that long. On the whole, I prefer to spend my time talking to people I can communicate with, because I just don't have time or the energy to try to get through to other people. I don't have the time, the ones who I don't immediately have a rapport with, you know. But as an actor, you have to try, you have to make that attempt. Eventually, though, you say, okay, I can't communicate with him, I can communicate with him. And you say, right, this is the person who's my friend, that one's not my friend, it's not my enemy, I won't spend any time with him. I'm finding out who I can spend my time with this week.
From me, pay no attention to what's said. Why people tell the things of anyone is over my head. Do nothing.
He takes two suits. No dinner suit. There'd be needed in a suit, he'll rent one or something. But mainly he dresses the same, but you know, you'll see him tomorrow in a suit for the first time, because you haven't seen him in a suit yet. I've packed everything else and he's only got a suit to wear. But he'll be in a suit tomorrow. He's not packing for America, it's packing for 4 months. I hate it. This is what he wears in the studio. These are his dressing gowns. Mine, my robe, his dressing gowns. Women's Lib should have Marty Feldman on their side, because he really has total understanding of women. He understands their emotional side. He understands how they function as human beings, and they do function differently to men. And Marty actually understands that. I mean, if you really want me to tell you the truth, when I have a period every month, Marty actually understands that. He understands the mental thing, the physical thing, and he knows it. He tells me 1 week before it, you're not going to be very good, you're a bit irritable, you have your period coming. I think the greatest compliment I can pay him is that I like him. And in order to love him, I have to like him. If I wasn't married to him, I'd like him to be my best friend. Which is all I can say about him. I would, really. Not only is he my husband, but he's my best friend. I have never met another man like him that can entertain me. First of all, that I can talk to. Second of all. And I'm saying, first and second, entertain and talk to. That I can actually want to stay on my own with and have no other company for 4 months, which is what we did, and not be with any other company, just be with him. So when you say, why do you love him? You've got to like somebody, first of all. You can love somebody, you can love somebody physically, you can... Why do I love you?
You tell the truth now.
Because
I'm adorable, because I'm handsome.
Yeah,
so that profile.
Yeah,
because of that smile. Because of those eyes. Because I'm so sexy.
Come on, lads. I'm coming at you again.
Quiet. frustrated cameraman, we all know it.
What's that?
He's a frustrated cameraman, he really is.
Yeah. Is it over?
Goodbye is the last word.
This is your captain speaking. There is absolutely no cause for alarm. The wings are not on fire. 1, 2, 3, 4.
Will all passengers return to their seats and fasten their safety belts immediately?
Immediately the emergency buzzer sounds.
Find your life jackets under your seats. Please get them immediately.
But they're in the racks above their heads.
I'm sorry, you will find them on the racks above your heads. Please reach up, get them immediately. But do not unfasten your safety belt. In 5 minutes' time, barring explosions, we should be landing at Manchester, or Rome, or Hanoi, or anywhere.
Who cares?
I spy with my little eye something beginning
sky. I spy with my little
cloud,
eye something beginning
cloud.
With N.
Mountains.
Mountains.